In this video, we're covering the general solution of an elastic collision where the target car is stationary. So in our diagram, the mass m1 is the only thing moving in the initial state, and it's moving at a speed of v0. It runs into the stationary mass 2. They collide elastically by way of an ideal springy bumper, and they both end up moving at their own speeds at the end of the process, so m1 has a speed of v1 and m2 has a speed of v2. Keep in mind that we use plus and minus signs to indicate direction here. So some combinations of masses will actually result in a reflection of m1 back to the left, but the sign on that velocity will take care of the direction, so we don't have to be concerned with that. So we're kind of guided through the problem in several parts, A, B, and C. And then on the next slide, we're going to run a couple physical checks to make sure that our general solutions are reasonable. And the first question here is to write down the equations expressing conservation of energy and momentum for the collision. So I'll go ahead and start out with the momentum equation. And we have that P initial is equal to P final, keeping in mind that these are vector quantities and we're using pluses and minuses to indicate direction. And our initial momentum is just M1 V0. And there's no contribution there from M2 because it's not moving. And then our final momentum is M1 V1 plus M2 V2. So there's our momentum equation, and then we write down our kinetic energy equation. So for an elastic collision, the initial kinetic energy is equal to the final kinetic energy, and the initial kinetic energy is 1/2 mv squared for the only thing that was moving. So that's 1/2 m1 v0 squared. And our final kinetic energy, well, there's two pieces to that. It's 1/2 m1 v1 squared plus 1/2 m2 v2 squared. Now this is a system of two equations and two unknowns. Our known quantities here are m1, m2, and v0. And the goal is to express v1 and v2, the final velocities, in terms of those known quantities. So we know in principle it's possible to solve for v1 and v2 this way because it's a system of two equations and two unknowns, but we're offered a little bit of advice along the way. So in part B, we're asked to solve for v1 in the momentum equation and then use substitution to find v2 first. So if I look at my momentum equation and try to figure out how to isolate V1, I just subtract the M2 V2 term from both sides and then divide by M1 and I'll have my V1. So when I do the subtraction, I get M1 V0 minus M2 V2. And again, to isolate V1, I have to divide by M1. So there's V1 in terms of V2. And now we can substitute into the kinetic energy equation. And in principle, we're done. We should be able to solve for V2. In practice, the algebra can get a little bit hairy. So I'm planning to go back and sub into the kinetic energy equation, and I can start by realizing that I could just multiply both sides by 2 and get rid of all those 1/2s. So at least I don't have to deal with that. Then on the left-hand side, I'll have an m1 v0 squared. On the right-hand side, an m1 v1 squared, and that's what I'm subbing in. So I'm going to replace v1 with all of this stuff, m1 v0 minus m2 v2 all divided by m1. When I square that, it squares the denominator of m1. So I'm going to move that out in front and write m1 over m1 squared. And then I have an m1 v0 minus m2 v2 quantity squared. So we're going to have to square that binomial. My last term on the right-hand side is an m2 v2 squared. So we can cancel one factor of m1 on this first term. And I'd rather not have anything in the denominator here. So I'm going to multiply both sides of this equation by m1. This gives me on the left-hand side an m1 squared v0 squared. And on the right-hand side, we'll just leave that squared binomial alone for now. And I also have a factor of m1 now added to my final term. So that's an m1 m2 v2 squared. Now we need to square that binomial, and that means multiply that binomial by itself, which results in a cross term. So my first term is going to be an m1 squared v0 squared. Then my cross term, I have twice that cross term, which is going to be a negative m1 m2 v0 v2. So I have negative 2 m1 m2 v0 v2. And then my final term, which is m2 squared v2 squared. And then this last term on the right-hand side, which was a spectator as we squared that binomial, m1 m2 v2 squared. Now, one of the mental checks that I did as I was solving this problem was just to make sure at this step that every term has the same units in it. And I notice that every single term has two factors of mass and two factors of velocity, guaranteeing that they have the same units. That's a really good trick for catching mistakes. Now we notice a nice thing happens with my left-hand term and the first term on the right-hand side. Those are equal. So when I subtract it from both sides, those are gone. And I have a zero on the left-hand side. On the right-hand side, I have all terms that contain at least one factor of V2. And I'll just clean things up a little bit and then highlight what we're going to do with it. So I left the first term alone for now. And then the two terms on the right, I can factor a V2 squared out of those. So I'm going to write it as V2 squared times a leftover M2 squared plus M1 M2. And at this point, I realize every single term has an M2 in it, so I could just divide one of those out. So there's an M2 gone from that first term, one of the M2s from the M2 squared is gone, and then the other M2 from the last term. So now on my left-hand side, still have zero, and I have a negative 2 M1 V0 V2 plus V2 squared times the quantity M2 plus M1. And this is a factorable quadratic equation. Just keep in mind that V2 is the unknown we're trying to solve for. So the way we handle these is to factor out one factor of V2, leaving me with a negative 2 M1 V0 plus V2 times the quantity M1 plus M2. I would just rather look at it in that order, M1 plus M2. And we get a solution to this equation if either one of these factors is equal to zero. So I have to ask myself, is it reasonable for V2 to be equal to zero? Well, it solves the equation, but that's a non-physical result. I know that M2 was just hit from the left by M1, so V2 can't be zero. So we're going to throw out that solution, and we only keep the solution obtained by setting the second factor equal to zero. So I set this second factor equal to zero, and when I do that, I'll go ahead and just add 2M1 V0 to both sides, and I end up with a 2M1 V0 is equal to M1 plus M2 times V2. And now I can quickly solve for V2. And I get 2M1 V0 divided by M1 plus M2. A nice clean final form for the solution. Now in part C, we're asked to compute V1 in terms of all the known quantities here, M1, M2, and V0. So we just have to go back to our original substitution, which we had a star around, and just sub in V2 and then try to clean it up as well as we can. Instead of having a divided by M1 at the end, I would rather have a 1 over M1 in front. And then I get M1 V0 minus M2 times V2. And now we have this expression for V2. So that's 2M1 V0 divided by M1 plus M2. Now, if I think about distributing the 1 over M1 into both of those terms, well, each of those terms contains a factor of M1 in the numerator. So that and that and that all cancel. And I end up with just a V0 minus M2 times this 2 V0 over M1 plus M2 term. I need a common denominator on those, so I multiply the V0 by M1 plus M2 divided by itself, and then I can go ahead and subtract the two fractions. So this leaves me with a V0 times M1 plus M2 in the numerator of the first fraction minus a 2 M2 V0 in the numerator of the second fraction, and that's all divided by M1 plus M2. Now if I distribute that V0 over the M1 plus M2, I notice that I get an M2 V0 term, and then I have a minus 2 M2 V0. So this just gives me a negative M2 V0 in the numerator. So now we can write this as M1 V0 minus M2 V0, all divided by M1 plus M2. And this answer has beautiful symmetry to it. Now I can write it as M1 minus M2 divided by M1 plus M2 times V0. So that accomplishes the main goal of the problem. We were trying to find the general solutions for V2, the velocity of the target car, and V1, the velocity of the initially moving car, in an elastic collision entirely in terms of M1, M2, and the initial velocity, V0. Now it's time to run a couple physical checks on our solution. So we'll bring our solutions in real quick. And this list of physical checks isn't exhaustive, but I wanted to try a couple things to make sure the solution made sense. So the first thing we're asked to try is to show that if M2 became infinite, we would end up with V2 equals zero and that V1 equals negative V0. So what I'm testing here is to make sure that if I replaced M2 with like a brick wall and I have an energy conserving collision with that brick wall with a spring on it, my original mass should get reflected back to the left with a speed equal to the initial speed in order to conserve kinetic energy. And of course, the brick wall shouldn't run away moving at all. So we test the limit as m2 goes to infinity for each of our velocities. And I mentioned v2 first, so we'll just start with v2. So I take the limit as m2 goes to infinity of v2 and see what happens. So that's the limit as m2 goes to infinity of 2m1 over m1 plus m2. Now, because m1 is finite, I have a finite numerator, and then my denominator is going to infinity. This unambiguously goes to zero. So it turns out the v2 is zero if I make its mass enormous. We try the same thing with v1. The limit as m2 goes to infinity of v1. That's the limit as m2 goes to infinity of m1 minus m2 over m1 plus m2 times v0. And I realize I forgot to stick a v0 in my expression for v2 up here, but it doesn't make a difference because zero times anything is zero. So what happens in the v1 case? Well, m2 is becoming infinite, and that means m1 is negligible in that numerator and the denominator, so we can simply ignore those. And I end up with a negative m2 over m2. Well, those are going to cancel and just give me a factor of negative 1. So this is the limit as m2 goes to infinity of negative v0. That's just a constant. So I get negative v0, and I find out that my mass is reflected with the same speed as the initial speed in order to conserve kinetic energy, so our solutions are making sense. Now, the other case I wanted to check is the case where m1 is equal to m2. And that's because I remember specifically what happens in that case. If the two masses are equal and you have a stationary target car, the collision results in the first mass coming to a stop, so v1 is zero, and the second mass running away with exactly the same speed as the first mass initially had. So I just happened to remember that this is a property of elastic collisions, and I wanted to make sure that my solutions would reproduce this. So if I look at v1, in the case where m1 is equal to m2, it's pretty clear what happens. I have an m1 minus m2 in the numerator, and since those are equal, that numerator vanishes, the denominator does not vanish, so I end up with zero. So v1 is equal to zero, and that's good. v2, that's 2m1 over m1 plus m2 times v0. And if all those masses are the same, maybe I'll just call them m. This gives me 2m over m plus m. Well, 2m over m plus m, that's 2m over 2m, that's 1. And I end up with v2 being equal to v0, as I should. So again, this list of physical checks isn't exhaustive. It would be interesting to see what happened if you let m1 become infinitely large, or either of the masses become negligibly small, just to make sure that the solutions keep making sense. But after doing a couple of these physical checks, we're getting really confident we have the correct solutions, and we're done. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.